All right, so I'm here to tell you just a little bit this morning about what our AP Environmental Science class is all about here at Conserve. So AP Environmental Science is offered at schools across the country, but here at Conserve School, we have a special opportunity to make it a little bit different than your run-of-the-mill AP Environmental Science class. So I'm just gonna call it science. AP Environmental Science is kind of a mouthful to get out every time. So it's our only science class here at Conserve, so we just call it science. Right, so some goals that we have for the class. So we work on balancing outdoor and indoor learning with the content that's required by the College Board. So the College Board sets what they expect to be covered in the class. So they give you a whole topic list and this whole breakdown of what you should be talking about. So we work on taking that seeing how we can get it to balance between outdoor learning and indoor learning and how we can make it our own here at Conserve. So we also are working on aligning the class with the next generation standards for science literacy. So this is an ongoing process, but the NGSS are standards that have been adopted by many schools across the country, and we're working on aligning our curriculum with that as well. So we also have secret hidden goals for the class maybe you pick up on after a little bit. So we're working on helping the students to develop either a new or different relationship with the world around them, to really see what's there and to understand it from a scientific perspective. We also would like our students to come to like a more holistic understanding of science learning, so engaging with their head and their hands and their heart. I've stolen that from one of our guest speakers, John Bates, a naturalist from the area. So he emphasizes the importance of all of those facets of learning. So engaging with your mind, with your hands doing things, and then also engaging with your heart. So bringing emotion and feeling to it. So as I described, the class is going to seem a little bit all over the board, and that's kind of on purpose. There's a lot that's going on in this class. So we cover a lot of different things. I'm going to give you a really quick flavor of a couple of them. So we'll do a lot of ecology work, so understanding about the relationships in the world that we see around us. We talk about water resources, there's geology, there's logging and mining, there's all of the different kinds of pollution. AP Environmental Science is pretty big on different types of pollution and the impacts that a lot of our practices have on the environment. So that's heavily emphasized in the class. We talk about types of energy, climate change. There's so much that goes into it. And that's one of the absolute beauties of this class, is that it incorporates a lot of different science disciplines. So you have biology, you have chemistry, you have physics. There's so much in there that students can find at least a little piece that they're super interested in. And then they get all of the rest of it as well. It's a very broad spectrum of things we talk about. We also have a special project in the class that isn't part of the traditional AP Environmental Science curriculum. And we refer to it as our Phenology Spot project or our Field Journal project. They're one and the same. We just call it a lot of different things. So throughout the course of the semester, we'll have students visit the same spot again and again. So we set aside our Wednesday mornings for this, at least most of the Wednesday mornings. So about 8 Wednesday mornings throughout the course of the semester, the students will go out to their spot that they've chosen. So it's around maybe Little Donahue Lake or Lake Elaine, even over to Big Donahue. The students will choose a place that they'll visit again and again. And when they go to their spot, they'll take their field journal with them they do an entry. And what we're asking the students to do as they sit there is to go through a process. We call it I notice, I wonder, it reminds me of, or a connection I see. So the process we're asking them to go through is to first observe. So scientists are good observers, and this gives the students the opportunity to practice, to observe what's around them. And then good scientists also ask questions. So they generate questions based on what they've seen. What do I wonder about? Can I find this answer? Do I observe more to find it? Is it something I can Google and come up with an answer for? Or is it something that maybe you would do an experiment to find out? And then we ask them to make a connection how does this thing I'm observing and asking questions about, how does that relate to something else I know? And so we ask the students to go through that process throughout the course of the semester. They also practice their field sketching skills. So there's a very beautiful relationship between science and art, and this is one of the ways we bring that out. So there's a quote, I forget who says it, it's a beautiful quote, but you never truly see a thing until you try to draw it. So you never truly see a thing until you sit down and you try to draw that thing. So it's a way of more intensely observing and seeing the world around you when you're asked to also sketch that thing. So the students practice throughout the semester doing that. And then at the end of the semester, we have a cumulative project where the students will convey a little bit about what they learned at their spot and what that means to them at the end of it all. So in simple terms, this class, we learn outside, we learn inside, and we try to fit what we're doing with how we're learning. So for instance, we can talk about water quality. So for water quality, you can talk about like the basics of water in the classroom. So maybe there's a little bit of background that we go into. Chapter 2 of almost every science textbook ever, I swear, is about water. So you can look it up and see. So water is so important. And so you can understand the basics of water in the classroom. But then you can take it and you can go outside and apply it. So you can go out and take a water sample. You can run some different tests on it to determine something about water quality. So there's chemical tests that you can do. So this student is doing a dissolved oxygen test. So she's fixing her water sample first. So that way the oxygen levels don't change. And then later she'll figure out how much dissolved oxygen is in it. And you can do water quality another way too. So you can look at macroinvertebrates that are present in the ecosystem. So you can take a net out, you can muck around at the edges of the lake and see what kind of little critters you can find. That can give you an indication based on what species you find and their relative abundance. That can also tell you something about the water quality of a system. So we can take information, we can expand on it in a lot of different ways, both indoors and outdoors. So the class itself has a couple of prerequisites that we would ask students to come with. And the first prereq is at least a year of science. Could be any kind of science, biology, chemistry, maybe it's environmental science already. But we'd ask they have a year of science with a C or higher. So that way students understand a little bit of how a science classroom functions and works and what kinds of things they could be learning. And then a year of algebra with a C or higher. So there's some math involved in AP Environmental Science. And as of right now, students are not allowed to use a calculator on the College Board exam for the class. So that means that we do some review of how to do math without a calculator. So we're thinking you're going to be practicing long division by hand, long multiplication by hand, doing some basic work with formulas, kind of plugging in numbers, converting units from one to another. So that's the kind of math we're looking for. And we find that a year of algebra is very helpful. You have the skills you need in order to do this math. It's just a matter of practicing it without a calculator. So over the course of a semester, the students get an entire year's worth of content. So it's a lot in kind of half the time they would usually have. So the students are, at the end of the class, prepared to take the College Board exam in May. So you have the potential to earn college credit if you score well on the exam. Different colleges have different standards for what they'll accept for AP scores, so that's a case-by-case basis when you apply for college. So students who come in the fall will have to wait to take the test in the spring. At their sending schools or at another local school, the College Board is very helpful about helping people find a place to take the test. So they have resources on their website that can help. But students who come in the spring semester will take the test here at Conserve School. So it's that first week in May. It's usually a morning test, so they'll come to school in the morning, they'll take the exam in the afternoon. We'll go back to regular class. But our course has passed the College Board audit, meaning that it's officially transcripted as an AP class, so that's what the transcript will read when you leave Conserve. And as I said, since it's a year-long class in a single semester, we have twice the number of class hours that other classes have, so we meet in both the mornings and the afternoons. The schedule's a little complicated, so I'm not gonna give you the nitty-gritty of that, but we meet very often, and we have a lot of fun in science. All right, I think that is the end of my presentation, but I don't have time for questions. So if you see me around at lunch, feel free to ask me anything. You can email me as well or get in touch. I love talking about the class.